Good morning, dear friends. Today, under the chapter of residential status, we shall be discussing number one, when is the firm or association of person is resident or non-resident. Number two, resident status of a company. And number three, the scope of total income as per the resident status. So, starting from the first point, when is the firm or association of person is resident or non-resident. An association of person considered to be resident, I just repeat it, the association of person or the firm is considered to be resident when either number one, full or partial control and management of its affairs are situated in India. It means it will be considered to be the resident in India when full or partial control and management of its affairs are situated in India. It means, what do you mean by that? The control and management of its affairs. The control and management of its affairs means, it means the power to take decisions, and in firms or in partnership firms or in association of persons, particularly when you talk of the firm, the power to take decision lies with the partners. If the meetings of the partners, they are usually taken in India, we can say that the control and management of its affairs is being situated in India. It means that it will be deemed to be the resident in India. If on the other hand, no part of its control is situated in India as far as control and management of its affairs is concerned, then it will be deemed to be the non-resident Indian status. It means if a company, if I just want to add one thing more, that in the case of firm or in association of persons, there is no classification as such of resident and ordinary resident and not ordinary resident. Means these particular things will just apply to the individuals, and HUF do not apply to the residential status of firms or of association of persons. It means you cannot classify the firm or association of persons between resident and ordinary resident or not ordinary resident, which is otherwise applicable to the individuals or HUF. So we were talking now, what do you mean by the non-resident firms or association of persons? As you can see from the definition, if no part of its control is situated, then it will be treated as non-resident Indian. Non-resident in India. It means all full control is situated outside India, then it will be deemed to be non-resident India. So, for any particular firm or associated person to be deemed to be resident in India, either it should have full or partial control and management of its affairs in India. I think the point is quite clear to you. Now we'll just take we'll just try to discuss the residential status of the company. How do we determine the residential status of the company? A company shall be deemed to be resident in India when, number one, it is an Indian company. Number two, it is a foreign company, but its whole of the, but its control and management of its affairs, is situated only in India. It means a company shall be deemed to be the resident of India, resident in India only when either it's an Indian company. What do you mean by Indian company? Indian company means a company which has been formed or incorporated under the Companies Act and its registered office is situated in India. If these two conditions are there, it means it has been incorporated under the Companies Act, it has been formed under the Companies Act, or it has been constituted under the Companies Act, and its principal office, its registered office, is also situated in India. Now, if it's an Indian company, then it will be holding the status of resident in India. Now, in the case of foreign company, for example, if a company is not an Indian company and it's a foreign company, but even if it's a foreign company, it can be resident in India, provided its control and management of its affairs is situated wholly in India. The control and management of its affairs means the decision-making power, where the decisions are being taken. For example, because the decisions are taken in the companies by the board of directors, and they just take decisions by holding the board of directors meeting. So if all the board of directors of a particular company or a foreign company, they are just taking place in India, it means the decisions are taken there in the board of directors meeting, that too in India, then it will be deemed to be an Indian company. I'll just try to explain this particular concept with an example. So I think with these two points are amply clear to you. I'll just try to explain it with an example. For example, A Limited Company is an Indian company. It is an Indian company. And during the financial year 2006 and 2007, all its board of director meetings, they took place at Nepal. So, first of all, A Limited is an Indian company, and during the financial year 2006-2007, all its board of directors meeting took place at Nepal. Can we say it's a foreign company or it is not holding the status of resident in India? All these board of directors meetings, they have just taken place outside India, still it will be deemed to be holding the status of resident in India. Because in the case of Indian company, it is immaterial whether its board of directors meetings they are taken in India or abroad. So by virtue of its having the status of Indian company, it will be deemed to be having the status of resident in India. So it doesn't matter where the board of directors meetings are being held. Since it's an Indian company, so it will be holding the status of resident in India. Now we just see what happens in the case of foreign company. Now say B Limited is a foreign company. And during the financial year 2006 and 2007, all its board of directors meetings were held in New Delhi. In this particular case, doubt is a foreign company, still it will be holding the status of a resident in India. Why? Because the control and management of its affairs, they were situated in India, because all of its board of directors meetings, they were held in Delhi, that's in India. That's why it will be holding the status of resident in India. Now I think the point would be amply clear to you. Because it is the place where the board of directors of the meeting are going to be held, that would be just the deciding point in respect of the foreign company. It means if all the board of directors meetings they are held in India, then this foreign company shall be deemed to be holding the status of resident in India. And in the case of Indian company, it is immaterial whether its board of directors meetings are held either in India or abroad. Even if all the meetings of the board of directors of Indian company, they are just held outside India, still it will be holding the status of resident in India by virtue of its definition. Because an Indian company is Indian company for the purpose of residency status. I think this is very clear to you now. Now we'll just take another topic. Now dear friends, we'll just try to discuss how to determine the scope of total income as per the residential status, particularly in respect of your resident and ordinary resident, not ordinary resident and not resident in India. It means these are the three categories, and these three categories, particularly if you just talk of this resident and non-resident and ordinary resident, non-ordinary resident and non-resident, when we talk of these three terms, immediately we just think of individuals and HUF. Because individuals and HUF, they can be classified under resident and ordinary resident. Non-ordinary resident means they are resident but not ordinary resident, and non-resident. So we just try to determine the means what sort of income is to be included in their total income in respect of these individuals and HUF. Please remember that the following incomes derived from any source are included in the total income of HUF, individuals only HUF, in the case of resident and ordinary resident. Means in the case of individuals or HUF who are having the status of resident and ordinary resident, then the following incomes, which I am just going to write, they would be included in the total income. Number one, all incomes received or deemed to be received by him or on his behalf in any part of the world. Number two, so all incomes received or deemed to be received in India by him or on his behalf. It means whatever income he has received or the income which is deemed to be received, how that income is received or deemed to be received, these are the terms which are quite frequently used in the scope of total income. The extended meaning of what exactly they refer, that we'll be discussing subsequent to that discussion. So for the time being, we can say that the following income which are derived from any source shall be included in the total income of individuals and HUF who are resident and ordinary resident. Number one, all incomes which are received or deemed to be received in India by him or on his behalf. Number two, all incomes which accrue or arise or deemed to accrue or arise either in India or outside India. It means any part of the world. It means if a person is resident, or individual is resident and ordinary resident, then all incomes which accrue either there in India or they arise, are deemed to accrue, arise in India or outside India, everything would be included his in total income. It means as per this scope of income, it means these two types of income, means all income which has been received by him or on his behalf, which is received in India or which is deemed to receive in India, that would be included in his income. Number two, all incomes which accrue or arises or are deemed to accrue or arise at any place in the world, means any part of the world, if it arises, then it will be included in his total income. And that particular status, scope of total income, is in respect of your individuals and HUF who are holding the status of resident and ordinary resident. Now we'll just see the scope of income in respect of non-resident or not ordinary resident. In the case of individuals only HUF who are resident but not ordinary resident, the following income shall be included in their total income. Number one, all the incomes which is received in India or deemed received in India either by himself or on his behalf by somebody else, that would be included in his total income. Number two, all incomes which arise or accrue are deemed to arise or accrue from a business or a profession set up in India. It means that if any income accrues or arises from a business which has been set up in India or a profession controlled and set up in India. Controlled or set up in India. It means these two type of incomes would be included in the total income of the individual and HUF in respect of resident but not ordinary resident. All the incomes which is received in India are deemed to be received in India by him or by somebody else on his behalf. Number one. Number two, all incomes which arise or accrue or deemed to arise accrue for a business in respect of a business or a profession which is controlled and set up in India. So now the third status is the third scope of income in respect of individual and HUF is when they happen to be non-residents. What is to be included? In this case, this particular class would be included. Point number one means all the income which is received in India are due to be received in India. I think this particular class is common to all because this type of income is to be included in respect of all the resident or non-resident, because the income which has been received in India or deemed to receive in India, that would be included in the total income. The second type of income which shall be included is that all income which accrues or arises. Any income which accrues or arises or deemed to accrue or arise in India. It means if a non-resident person has earned any income, the accrual of which has taken place in India, then it will be included in his total income. It means all the income which has been received in India or deemed to be received in India by him or by somebody else on his behalf. Number two, any income which accrues to him or arises to him in India, then it will be taxable in his hands. Yes, dear friends, now we just try to know the meaning of various terms which are being quite frequently used in the scope of total income. Recently, we have used several words: income received in India, income deemed to be received in India, income arises in India, or accrues in India, or deemed to arise, accrue in India. We just try to know the extended meaning of these terms. What are the meaning of these terms? Number one, if you just take income received in India. Income received in India means the receipt of income in the hands of the recipient. It means this is the receipt of income in the hands of the recipient. Actually, he will be receiving the income. But what is more important is that in this case, the first occasion we'll have to evaluate the first occasion of its receipt, means the first occasion of the receipt of the income under the control of the recipient. It means the first control will decide whether it will be construed to the income received in India or not. For example, it is first occasion of its receipt in the hands of recipient. It means there will be some instances where the income has been received at some other place, but later on it has been sent to India to a person that It means that it will not be deemed to be received. It will not be received by the person. Rather, it would be the remittance of the income. For example, I just say that one Mr. A. Mr. A, he is a citizen of South Africa. And he comes to India for a period of stay. During his stay here in India for 2 months, he receives his salary from his employer, from South Africa, direct in India. It means, at this case, at this moment, he will be receiving that particular salary in India. It means, he is just receiving the salary, or receiving his salary income at the first occasion, then it will be deemed as, yes, income received in India, and in this particular case, this income shall be subject to tax in India. Now, the same person, for example, the same person, he has come to India, he is a citizen of South Africa, and he remains in India for 2 months. In between, the employer of Mr. A, who is just there in South Africa, he gives the salary of Mr. A to the wife of Mr. A at South Africa, and his wife remits the salary to Mr. A in India. It means, in this case, however, he is getting the salary from his wife, in this case, it will not be deemed as an income received in India, rather, it will be taken as the remittance of income, and in this particular case, it will not be subject to tax in India. So, this income received in India means, in this context, the first occasion of receipt, that is more important. It means, the person is saying, here is, in the above example, I think the thing would be very clear, the point would be very clear to you. The receipt of income in India means the first occasion of its receipt in the control of recipient, in the hands of recipient, then it will be deemed as the income received in India. I think that should be quite clear to you. Now, I just take another point. Next is income deemed to be received in India. I say that the following income shall be, the following income shall be deemed to be received in India. I'll just take a few examples and I think you can well understand the concept of income deemed to be received in India. For example, I can say the excess of the contribution of employer to the recognized provident fund in excess of 12% of the salary of the employee. It means, if an employer contributes in excess of 12% of the salary of the employee to the recognized provident fund, then the excess amount is deemed to be the income received in India. Number two, the interest credit to the recognized provident fund of the employee in excess of 8.5% per annum. Previously it used to be 9.5%, now it's 8.5% per annum. That will be deemed to be the income received in India. The third example I can give you is the taxable transfer balance to the recognized provident fund from the unrecognized provident fund. That also is deemed to be the income received in India. And the fourth is, I can say, TDS, means the tax deducted at source shall be the income deemed to be received in India. So we can explain this concept with this example. The third meaning is income accrues or arises in India. The term accrues means the birth of right to receive the income. It is called accrual, arise. It means if you are getting some right, it's a birth of right to receive some income in India, that's called accrues or arise in India. The next point is, the next item is income deemed to accrue or arise in India. I think the following income shall be the income deemed to accrue or arise in India. You can explain it like that. Income which is deemed to accrue or arise in India. It may be, number one, it can be the income which has been received, income which accrues or arises out of any business connection in India. Business connection in India. If we are getting any income out of the business connection in India, then the income is deemed to accrue or arise in India. Number two, any income which is derived from any property, asset, any income which is derived from any property or asset in India, it is also called income deemed to accrue or arise in India. The third example is any income which is derived out of the sale of any capital asset in India, it is also called income which is deemed to accrue or arise in India. The fourth example can be the salary, means income under the head salary, it is also the income which accrues or arise in India. Or if any payment has been made by the government of India to any citizen of India, being its employee, and who has just contributed his services out of India, it will be the income which is deemed or accrue or arise in India. Next example can be, it can be the dividend, it can be your technical fee, or it can be the dividend which has been paid by an Indian company outside of India. These are some of the examples which come under the income deemed to accrue or arise in India. So I think we can again elaborate the various issues which have just arisen under this particular chapter, residential status. We can explain these things by taking various examples in our next class. Thank you.